from Belgaum. I have done my MBBS and MD in forensic medicine, and I have worked in several countries, and currently I'm working in Belgaum. With this brief introduction about myself, a long drive from southern India. Okay. Moving on. Presentation is like some. First, we will be dealing with the introduction. Then we have the materials and methods, result, and reference. Moving on to introduction. Identification in individual's identity is very important, whether we are living or we are dead. Irrespective of that, identification is a very important feature. Okay, especially in forensics. And when it comes to forensic scenario, whether it's a pathologist or a forensic scientist or an anthropologist, who is dealing with that, identification features like race, sex, or gender, age, and stature, which form the primary identification features, are very important. And moving on to the primary identification feature, stature, there are two types of methods that estimate that exist. One is the anatomical method, and one is the another requires of a complete skeleton, and this has a limited role, as in a complete body should be available, and all the lengths of all the long bones, the head, everything is assessed, it's calculated, added up, losses of which are added up, and which is estimated. So because in case the body which is presented to us is dismembered or mutilated. There is another method which is called a mathematical method, which requires a complete or partial long bone, partial long bone, or a body part, a dismembered body part, or whatever it is. So a body need not be in its entirety. And this method employs something called as regression formula. And the funda behind this is the identification or correlation that exists between body parts and the stature. So that is the basis behind this. So like I said, the various body parts, like it could be your fingers, it could be just the arm or leg or whatever body parts, they are in constant with the stature or height, and these measurements of this body part and the because of the ethnic considerations, it could be because of geographical location, it could be because of the nutritional status, the physical activity, and the environment in which the people are living. And of course, though we say there are minimal studies that are there, there are a lot of studies that have been done, except in cases where the populations are very ancient or they are very unique, which have been separated geographically or genetically or culturally. These populations are very less, because today's modern era, where transportation and communication is being accessed by everyone, and so there is a lot of intermingling, and consequently there is interbreeding and other factors. So pure races are quite less. So moving on to the materials and methods that we employed in this study was, totally we involved 98 healthy people from the Soliga tribal population. Of course, when I said genetically isolated population, I was referring to Soliga tribal population, which is found in the southern part of Karnataka in India. So they stay in the forest. They have the old ancient cultures, and they have their own unique feeding habits and the dwelling and lifestyle. And that's a very ancient tribe. So I forgot to mention, this is an introduction, so I have to mention here. So we did a study on these 98 individuals. Of this 98 individuals, 46 were males and 52 were females. And all of them had completed 25 years of age, because the epiphyseal fusion of bones does not happen until 25 years of age. So we wanted to take out this problem. So we collected from people who are 25 years of age and above. And it was collected in a two-week period between 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. Just to avoid the influence of diurnal variation. And of course, we excluded people who had any chronic illness. It could be tuberculosis or chronic renal disease or whatever. We excluded people with dwarfism or gigantism, somebody who is on steroidal therapy or who had sustained trauma, or there was any physical deformity, or who would have undergone any surgical procedure that could have affected the stature of the head. So these were the exclusions that we made in the study. And the study was conducted in adherence to the principles of Declaration of Helsinki and within the legal boundaries. And mainly the study wouldn't be an invasive method anyways. So anyways, despite all this, we took informed consent from all, written informed consent, and all the female subjects were examined at presence of another female, just in complying with the guidelines. And then we used standard instruments to make all the measurements. And then we had to define the parameters of the study. Basically, head length of each subject was measured in centimeters to was measured in centimeters, and all measurements were taken in a well-illuminated room. All measurements were performed by the same individual, just to reduce the inter-observer errors. And coming to the measurement definition of these parameters, stature, we took stature we determined stature using a stereometer. As I told, it was measured in centimeters. And the procedure that we followed was we asked the subjects to stand barefooted on a stereometer platform with the feet in close contact to each other. And the trunk was placed along the board. And the eyes, they asked them to look straight ahead. And the face was faced in the flankfurt plane. And we took the measurements by bringing the projecting horizontal sliding bar to the vertex. So the point of vertex to the point of foot represented the stature in our study. And moving on to head length, it was we took the parameter, like the head length was measured by using a small spreading caliper with rough edges, and we measured, of course, in centimeters. Here, the procedure that we followed was the subject was asked to stand comfortably in a Frankfurt plane, and the distance between the glabella and the external occipital protuberance represented the head length of our study. And after that, after we gathered the data, it was filled in the pro forma, then we populated in the Excel sheet, and then we analyzed it using the SSPS software. And of course, the mean, standard deviation, ranges and differences were estimated. An independent t-test was used to test for differences between mean measurements in the study. Strength of correlation between stature and head length was calculated using Pearson correlation coefficient. And then after doing all this exercise, sex-specific or gender-specific regression equations, and also combined regression equations for stature estimation were developed using the head length. And the equation that we determined in this study was of the type y is equal to a plus b into x plus or minus the standard error of estimation, where y represented the stature, a is a constant that comes out of the study, b is a regression coefficient of the independent variable, and x is the individual variable. For example, it's the head length of this study. And a p-value of less than 0.05 was considered statistically significant in our study. And any standard error of estimation, which is less, indicates a higher accuracy. The equations were tested using the by substituting the mean, the maximum, and means of head length in respect to regression equations to estimate the stature. And then a paired sample t-test was employed to compare the differences between the actual and estimated means using derived equations. Moving on to the results, here is a table that represents the combined distribution of stature and head length in this particular study. And here the table shows that age, the mean age in our study was 37.74 years. The maximum age of the individual was 61. The elder person in our study was 61 years. The minimum was 25 years. The maximum, the mean height that we observed was 158.17 centimeters. And the maximum height seen was 175 centimeters, so minimum 143 centimeters with a standard deviation of 8 centimeters. Head length mean was 17.31 centimeters, maximum was 20 centimeters, minimum was 15 centimeters with a standard deviation of 0.955 centimeters. And further, the gender-wide distribution of stature and head length is shown in this table. Again, where you could see that males, the mean was 164.39 centimeters with respect to the height of stature, then the maximum height was 175 centimeters, the minimum was 150 centimeters. In females, it was 152.67 as a mean, maximum 165 and minimum was 143 centimeters. And when it came to head length, once the head length mean was 17.88 centimeters. And of course, the maximum head length in males was 20 centimeters, the minimum was 17 centimeters. Maximum seen in females was 19 centimeters, minimum in was 15 centimeters. And P was 0.00. So this means it was statistically significant. And then coming to the results of, further moving on to the results, we using all this data, we calculated, we conducted the regression analysis and considered as an individual parameter, independent parameter, and stature we considered it as a dependent one. The coefficient, correlation coefficient between stature and head length will be shown in the next table. And we found that combined estimates gave better correlation of both genders. And females especially presented with the lowest correlation coefficient. So here, this is the set of linear regression equations that we estimated in the study for males, females, and the combined estimates. And we can see that the correlation coefficient is minimal for females, and next followed by males, and the highest was in case of the combined equations that we generated. And the p-values are as shown, and more significant would be in case of combined combined equations. And again, the actual stature and the estimated stature from the minimum, maximum, and means of upper limb measurements, the head length were compared using various regression equations. Sorry, there's a typological error there. Again, here you can see the maximum actual is 143, estimated is 148 when it comes to minimum. Maximum is actual is 175, estimated is 169.396. And mean is actually is 159.18 and estimated is 158.18 centimeters. So T values is 0.002 and P value is 0.99. Likewise, in case of this is for the stature which is combined, then again for males separately we have calculated and females separately we have calculated, and the values are as shown in this table. For example, stature in case of males, the maximum 175, the estimated is 168, and in case of mean, actual 164, estimated 164. And again, when it comes to females, the actual was 165, maximum was 165, estimated 154, mean was 152 and estimated was 152.68. Likewise, t-test was conducted for everything and p-value was calculated. Here we can see that the greatest variations were observed in minimal and maximum values. In both genders, the mean estimates were close to the actual stature and there was no statistically significant difference between them. So that was about the results. Moving on to the discussion parts, as I earlier told, Soligas are an ancient arboreal forest type of forest tribe of wedded type. They are Dravidian speaking and forest dwelling tribes who are seen in the states of Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, and India. In the state of Karnataka in India, they are distributed in forests of Pilgiri Rangana Betta or BR Hills and other hilly parts of Mysore and Chamarajanagar districts. And they represent their genetic isolate in BR Hills, and they do not interbreed with neighboring populations and have maintained a distinct genetic pool. Soligas possess the lowest number of alleles and heterogeneity when compared with all the worldwide populations. We have estimated stature among this unique tribal population of BR Hills. Average stature seen in our study is 164.39 centimeters in males and 152.67 centimeters in females, as shown in the table before. These findings are less when it comes to stature with the other studies. There are several studies, most of the studies that have been conducted in India, this is lesser compared to that, because it could be because of the poor dietary factors, because they are living in isolation and they do not have access to the real world and other things. They still follow the primitive eating habits. So that could be the reason for this, and this could also be because of environmental factors, or mainly it could be because of the genetic composition itself. So this could be the reason. The head length observed in our study is 128.88 centimeters in males and 16.8 centimeters in females, and the average for a combined sample is 17.31 centimeters. One second, I'm having a problem with my mic. Hello. Yeah, in similar studies conducted by Kamal B, mean of head length of males was 18.43 centimeters and females was 17.63 centimeters, and by Singh, this was conducted by Singh, and mean of head length of males was 17 centimeters and females was 16 centimeters. Also, it is studied by Akhtar Z of Bangladeshi Garo Azad females. Mean of head length was observed to be 17.49 centimeters, which is larger when compared to the present female stature. This is in accordance to the hypothesis that there exist inter and intra population differences, and these are all secondary to variations in genetic, environmental, and dietary habits. The difference of means of heights and head length as measured by pair tests between males and females is significant, and the values in males are higher. And this is in accordance to observations made by Agniotri et al. In this study on Indo-Mauritian population. This observation is attributable to direct relationship of body dimensions with sex of an individual, since difference in hormonal status results in early hormonal maturity in females in comparison to males, consequently reducing the time involved in growth. In the present study, regression analysis revealed positive correlationship between height and the only for the males when both sexes were combined, a p-value was less than 0.05. However, correlation was insignificant in case of females. And this is similar to observations made by Agniotri et al. On Indo-Mauritian population, where correlation coefficient of all kyphalofacial dimensions was less than 0.5 in both the sexes. This observation is also in accordance to another study by Pelinci on Turkish population, where it was observed that correlation coefficient between head length and stature was low, changing only between 0.012 and 0.229. Contrastingly, other studies done on North Indian population, it was found that all kyphalofacial measurements were significantly correlated with the stature, where P was quite significant in the studies. These observations validate the hypothesis that there exist various inter and intra-population differences, which are secondary to variations in genetic, environmental, and dietary habits. Our study, we deduced three simple regression equations. However, the regression coefficient and standard error of estimate with respect to head length is lower compared to many other body dimensions used in routine forensic practices. It could be like the femoral length, it could be tibia length or ulnar length, etc. So it is relatively inferior compared to these long bone parameters in using it as a dimension to estimate stature. So moving on, compared to other things, only when head is available as the only body part for forensic experts, I think it is the only and the better parameter that could be used with a great degree of reliability to estimate the stature. Just to assess the accuracy, means of minimum, maximum, and average head length were applied to respective equations, and when means of estimated values and original values compared, statistically insignificant differences, that is P then less than 0.05 were seen, which implied that equations could be applied to the Soliga tribal population with acceptable margins of error for routine forensic practice. All these studies, anthropological studies, are more of mathematical jargons. It's more easily understood by the statisticians than the experts themselves. But the brighter side, they are more useful for forensic experts like us during estimation of stage. Anyways, just to conclude our study, we have derived. In our study, we have conducted regression analysis, and we have seen positive correlation between stature and the head length. And correlation is stronger in males than in females. And when they are combined, the correlation enhances much more. And head length is useful in assessment of stature when only a head is presented to a forensic expert for examination. So these are the few conclusions that we draw out of this study, and this concludes my presentation. And here are a few of the references that we used in conducting this study. So thank you everyone, thank you so much.
So thank you, Mr. Vinay.
Thank you.
So your presentation is very nice, sir.
Thank you.
Anyone having any doubts or question for Dr. Mr. Vinay?